Hey guys, today we're diving into a must-know tool for anyone who's getting started with circuits, the breadboard. You've probably heard of it, maybe even seen one, but do you know how to use it effectively? Well, you will by the end of this video. What is a breadboard? This small rectangular piece of plastic has a grid of tiny holes, and it's the go-to tool for building circuits quickly and easily without soldering. You simply push electronic components like LEDs, resistors, or jumper wires into the holes, and the breadboard does the magic of connecting them electrically. If you're just starting, you're probably wondering, why use a breadboard? Good question. Let me explain. Here I have a breadboard and a PCB or printed circuit board. A breadboard is used for testing circuits. It's great for quickly building and changing circuits without soldering during the design phase. A PCB is a permanent way to build final circuits. It requires soldering components onto a board with specific paths for a durable, stable connection. Now here's a fun fact. Why is it called a breadboard? If you're picturing a board used to slice bread, you're actually not too far off. Back in the early days of electronics, inventors literally used wooden cutting boards. Yes, the kind you'd cut bread on, as the base to build circuits. They'd hammer in nails and wrap wires around them to connect components. Over time, that evolved into what we use today, but the name stuck. Cool, right? All right, let's talk about the different types of breadboards you might come across. Breadboards come in all sorts of sizes, but the most common ones are full-size, half-size, and mini breadboards. Full-size breadboards are great when you have a lot of components and need more space. Half-size breadboards are the sweet spot for most beginner projects, compact enough to fit on your desk, but with plenty of space to work. Mini breadboards are great for smaller circuits, or when you're tight on space. Many breadboards even come with little notches or tabs that allow you to snap them together. So, if your project outgrows your board, just snap on another one. While most breadboards are white, you can find them in all sorts of colors. It won't affect their performance, but hey, why not add a little style to your project? Now, let's dive into how this magical little board actually works. On the back of the breadboard is a layer of double-sided tape covered by protective paper. Let's peel off the paper and see what's inside. The first layer is the double-sided tape. You can stick this breadboard permanently to a board or any flat surface. Let's peel off the double-sided tape. When I peel off the tape, it reveals rows and rows of metal clips. Each hole on a breadboard is connected to metal clips inside. These clips make an electrical connection with the component you plug in, like an LED or a wire. And because it's a solderless breadboard, you don't need to solder anything in place. You can just push components in and pull them out as needed. This makes troubleshooting and modifying your circuits incredibly easy. Let's remove one metal strip and see it up close. I'm going to push it out from the front side using the legs of the LED. One metal strip makes up half the column of the breadboard. These metal strips are what make the electrical connections for you. It's like having invisible wires inside the board that connect your components together. Let's zoom in on the breadboard's layout. The holes are arranged in rows and columns. The rows are labeled with letters, A, B, C, etc., and the columns with numbers, 1, 2, 3, and so on. These labels are super helpful when following a circuit diagram, as they give you exact spots for placing components. For example, if the instructions say to place a wire in hole C5, you know that's where column C and row 5 intersect. But here's an important thing to note. The breadboard is split down the middle by a gap. The holes on either side of this gap are not connected to each other. So, if you plug something into a hole on the left side, it won't be connected to the holes on the right unless you use a jumper wire to bridge the gap. Next, let's talk about the long strips that run along the top and bottom of your breadboard. These are called power rails or power buses. They're usually marked with red and blue lines, along with plus and minus signs. These strips are used to distribute power to your circuit. Typically, you'll connect the positive terminal of your battery or power source to the red rail and the negative terminal to the blue or black rail. A super important concept when using a breadboard is understanding how the holes are connected. Each set of five holes in a row, like A5, B5, C5, is connected electrically, meaning if you plug a wire into one, it will be connected to all the other holes in that row. But remember, the rows on either side of the center gap are not connected, so rows A through E are separated from rows F through J. On the other hand, the power rails are connected vertically, so the holes running up and down the red line are all connected to each other, and the same goes for the blue line. All right, now that you've got the basics down, let's build a simple circuit. For this, we'll use a battery, an LED, and a resistor. Here's what you do. First, connect the positive lead of your battery holder to the red power rail and the negative lead to the blue power rail. Next, plug one leg of your LED into the same column as the positive terminal and the other leg into the middle column. Make sure the longer leg is on the left side. Now, plug one end of a resistor into that same row and the other end into the blue power rail or the negative terminal. Let's insert the batteries to the battery holder. The LED lights up. That's your basic circuit. Pretty neat, right? Now let's add more LEDs to the breadboard. I've turned the breadboard horizontally so I can make room for the other LEDs. Plug one end of the longer leg of the LED into the red power rail. Plug the other end of the LED into the middle row. This time I'm using a jumper wire to connect to the next column. Make sure the left leg of the jumper wire is in the same row as the LED. Plug one leg of the resistor into the same row as the other right leg of the jumper wire. Plug the other leg of the resistor into the blue power rail. Connect the negative lead of the battery holder to the blue power rail. Connect the positive lead of the battery holder to the red power rail. The LED lights up, so we've connected our circuit correctly. Let's continue this same process for the blue LED. Since we have placed the breadboard horizontally, it may take some time for you to get adjusted to the orientation of the power rails. You may want to review the earlier sections of this video. You may want to start with the breadboard vertically first. Once you've successfully connected the circuit a few times, you can have the breadboard placed horizontally. As you can see, the jumper wires bend very easily, so you want to insert them carefully. The blue LED lights up. It's time to connect the green LED. The green LED lights up. Let's talk about a few common mistakes people make when using a breadboard. Move one leg of the LED to another row, and you'll see it won't light up because the components aren't connected in the same row anymore. You always need to keep the parts of your circuit in the same row to maintain the connection. I'm going to slightly insert the resistor into the breadboard. Since the wire isn't pushed in all the way, it does not make a good connection, so the LED turns on and off. When inserting your component into the breadboard, ensure it's securely in place. Some components, like LEDs, have polarity, meaning they need to be connected in a specific direction. Let's reverse the LED and see what happens. As you can see, the LED doesn't light up. The longer leg of an LED is the positive side, so it must connect to the positive rail. Before we wrap up, here are a couple more pro tips. If you're using an IC or integrated circuit chip, place it over the center gap so that each row of pins on the chip has its own set of connected holes. Try to keep your circuit neat by using jumper wires of appropriate lengths. This will help you troubleshoot and make modifications more easily. Whether you're building a simple LED circuit or working on more complex projects, a breadboard is your best friend. I hope this video has shown you how to use a breadboard. If you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up, consider subscribing for more electronics tips and tutorials, and hit the bell icon to never miss an update. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.